God. Let's start with prayer. Father in heaven, we come before you. We thank you for the day. Thank you for the day of worshiping you and lifting you up in praise. That's something that we need to do on a regular basis, even throughout the week. We can lift you up. Be with us today. Help us to hear your word and help us apply it to our lives that we might grow as your children. We pray in Jesus' name. Amen.
Amen.
David had been a great king of Israel, and David ruled over Israel for a period of about 40 years. And David was followed by his son Solomon, who started out as a good king of Israel. Remember, God blessed Solomon. Solomon asked God for wisdom, and God gave it to him. Solomon was quoted as being the wisest man who ever lived. But after a few years, Solomon's loyalty to God began to wane. Solomon had 300 wives and 700 concubines. Now that's a lot. God warned Solomon not to follow after the pagan gods of all his diversity of wives. But Solomon didn't listen. He followed them. It's an interesting story to read how Solomon began to get further and further and further off the track. And in his latter years as king, Solomon became very disloyal and unfaithful to God in his latter years as king. Now, turn with me, if you will, to 1 Kings, and that's our text for today. 1 Kings 11, verses 29 through 39. That's the first part. The lectionary had two scriptures, so we're going to use those two scriptures. 1 Kings 11, verses 29 through 39. About that time, Jeroboam was going out of Jerusalem, and Ahijah was a prophet. The prophet of Shiloh met him on the way wearing a new coat. That is, Jeroboam had a new coat. The two of them were alone out in the country, and Ahijah took hold of the new coat he was wearing and tore it into 12 pieces. Then he said to Jeroboam, "Take 10 pieces for yourself, for this is what the Lord, the God of Israel, said. See, I am going to tear the kingdom out of Solomon's hand and give you 10 tribes. But for the sake of my servant David and the city of Jerusalem, which I have chosen out of all the tribes of Israel, he will have one. I will do this because they have forsaken me and worship Asherah, the goddess of the Zidonians, Chemosh, the god of the Moabites, and Molech, the god of the Amorites, and have not walked in obedience to me, nor done what is right in my eyes, nor kept the decrees and laws of David, Solomon's father, as he did." Verse 34. "But I will not take the whole kingdom out of Solomon's hand. I have made him ruler all the days of his life for the sake of David my servant, whom I chose, and who obeyed my commands and decree. I will take the kingdom from his son's hand and give you 10 tribes. I will give one tribe to his son, so that David my servant may always have a lamp before me in Jerusalem, the city where I chose to put my name. However, as for you," he's talking to Jeroboam, "I will take you, and you will rule over all the, I will take you, and you will rule over all that your heart desires. You will be king over Israel. If you do not do whatever I command you and walk in obedience to me and do what I have is right in my eyes by obeying my decrees and commands as David my servant did, I will be with you. I will build you a dynasty as enduring as the one I built for David, and I will give Israel to you. I will humble David's descendants because of this, but not forever. Now, in this account, we see that God selected Jeroboam to become king of Israel because of the evil and the wicked deeds of Solomon. It was time for a change, and God was now bringing on Jeroboam. Now, turn over a few couple chapters to chapter 14, the second text. First Kings chapter 14. Let's read that. At that time, Abijah, now we have Ahijah, who was a prophet, and we have Abijah, who was Jeroboam's little son. So don't get them confused, because first it takes you a few times to read that to get that. At this time, Abijah, son of Jeroboam, became ill, and Jeroboam said to his wife, "Go disguise yourself so you won't be recognized as the wife of Jeroboam. Then go to Shiloh. Ahijah, the prophet, is there, the one who told me I would be king over this people. Take 10 loaves of bread with you and some cakes and a jar of honey and go to him. He will tell you what will happen to the boy." He's a prophet. He can tell you what's going to happen to my son. So Jeroboam's wife did what he said and went to Ahijah's house in Shiloh. Now, Ahijah could not see. His sight was gone because of his age. But the Lord told Ahijah, "Jeroboam's wife is coming to ask you about her son, for he is ill, and you are to give her such and such an answer. When she arrives, she will pretend to be someone else." So when Ahijah heard the sound of her footsteps at the door, he said, "Come in, wife of Jeroboam. Why this pretense? I have been sent to you with bad news. Go tell Jeroboam that this is what the Lord, the God of Israel, says. I raised you up from among the people and appointed you ruler over my people Israel. I tore the kingdom away from the house of David and gave it to you, but you have not been like my servant David, who kept my commands and followed me with all his heart, doing only what was right in my eyes. You have done more evil than all who lived before you. You have made for yourself other gods, idols made of metal. You have aroused my anger and turned your back on me." Verse 10. "Because of this, I am going to bring disaster on the house of Jeroboam. I will cut off from Jeroboam every last male of Israel, slave or free. I will burn up the house of Jeroboam as one burns dung until it is all gone." So Jeroboam was made king over Israel, and he in all actuality became just like all the other leaders of Israel. Can you imagine that? God set him apart, gave him a special privilege to be ruler over Israel. But he did like all the other kings. He did exactly the opposite of what God wanted him to do. Now, you notice between these two texts, chapter 11 and chapter 14, there's two chapters. There's chapter 12 and chapter 13. And there's a tremendous amount of history outlined in those two chapters. But I'm following the lectionary, so those are the texts that they outlined for us. I'm going to kind of fill in a little of that. Now, Jeroboam actually followed Rehoboam, Solomon's son, as the king of Israel after Solomon died. Rehoboam, Solomon's son, was a cruel leader, and that's when the Israelites split into two nations. the 10 tribes who became the nation of Israel and the nation of Judah, consisting of Judah and Benjamin. Ahijah the prophet prophesied that the garment would be torn into 12 pieces. And he said that 10 pieces representing the 10 tribes of Israel will be ruled by Jeroboam, and Judah and Benjamin, the other two pieces, will remain under Rehoboam's rule. And God told Jeroboam how he wanted him to rule over Israel. You get the picture? Yet Jeroboam, who came out of this new court, he was met by the prophet of God. The prophet of God had something to tell him. He says, I'm going to take this new coat you have. I'm going to tear it in 12 pieces. Now, God is prophesying that you're going to be made king over Israel, which is represented by 10 of these pieces. The other two pieces, which represents Judah and Benjamin, I'm going to leave with Rehoboam, who is Solomon's actual son. But Rehoboam was so evil, that caused a split. I hope you can follow that. Now, this is God told Rehoboam how he wanted him to rule Israel. Let's just take a look back at chapter 11 and verse 37. We're getting someplace with this. However, this is verse 37 of 1 Kings 11. However, as for you, I will take you and you will rule over all that your heart desires. You will be king over Israel. If you do whatever I command you and walk in obedience to me and do what is right in my eyes by obeying my decrees and demands, as David my servant did, it will be with you. I will build you a dynasty as enduring as the one built for David, and will give Israel to you. I won't read verse 39. So how did Jeroboam do then after God had given him this responsibility? Rather than trusting God and believing God, Jeroboam became very insecure as leader. He reasoned, you know, if I allow my people Israel to go up to Jerusalem for this coming fall festival, then they might remember the ties they had with Rehoboam and Judah, and the ties that they had with David and Solomon, and drop me as their king. So Jeroboam devised several ways to secure his position as king. This is what he did. Number one, he built two golden calves. What did we hear about calves before?
Coming out of Israel.
Moses was up getting the law, the tablets. And Aaron, down on the ground, was building these two calves. But anyway, that's what Jeroboam did. He built two golden calves. He put one at one end of his kingdom and one at the other end. And he said, now you don't have to travel up to Jerusalem to keep this fall festival and worship God. You can worship God right here at home in the kingdom. You won't have to travel. Another thing he did, he built several shrines or centers of worship at various points throughout the kingdom, and appointed priests from all sorts of people rather than the Levites. He also instituted a different festival, a copy of the one that Israel was supposed to observe, and offered sacrifices to the golden calves. This is what Rehoboam did. He installed priests in the high places, in the shrines or the places of worship, so that they would preside over the services. And God pronounced a scathing indictment against Jeroboam. Take a look at chapter 13, verse 33. Chapter 13, verse 33. Even after this, Jeroboam did not change his evil ways, but once more appointed priests for the high places from all sorts of people. Everyone who wanted to become a priest, he concentrated for the high places. This was the sin of the house of Jeroboam that led to his downfall and to its destruction from the face of the earth. And then verse chapter 14, verses 8 and 9, 8 through 10. Verse 8. I tore the kingdom away from the house of David and gave it to you, Jeroboam. But you have not been like my servant David, who kept my commands and followed me with all his heart, doing only what was right in my eyes. You have done more evil than all who lived before you. You have made for yourselves other gods, idols, made of from metal. You have aroused my anger and turned your back on me. Verse 10, because of this, I am going to bring disaster on the house of Jeroboam. I will cut off from Jeroboam every male child of Israel, slave or free. I will burn up the house of Jeroboam as one burns dung until it's all gone. Now notice why God rejected Jeroboam. I tore the kingdom away from the house of David and gave it to you, but you have not been like my servant David, who kept my commands and followed me with all his heart, doing only what was right in my eyes. Now, what do you think Jeroboam was thinking? When God says the primary reason why I'm going to tear the kingdoms out of your hand is because you have not been like my servant David, who kept my commands and followed me with all of his heart, doing only what was right in my eyes. I'm imagining that Jeroboam is saying, what kind of God is this? Are you trying to tell me that David followed you, kept your commands, and did only what was right? Which David are you talking about? I know the history of our nation. You know, they didn't have schools where they sent their kids halfway across the city. They were lived in tribes. They knew the history of their people. They knew about Israel coming out of Egypt, the 40 years that they were in the wilderness, how the Egyptians taught them. This was taught, you know, all the time in the tribes. The elders were there. They told the kids. They knew about David. They knew about Solomon. They knew all of this local history. Jeroboam is imagining and saying, is this the David who was up on his roof and who saw Miss Bathsheba on her roof, and you inquired about her and found out that she was Mrs., but you still invited her to dinner? Is this the David, the same David, who after impregnating her wanted to have a conversation with her husband who was in the battlefield, called him in, trying to get him drunk so he could go and sleep with his wife, but he didn't do it. And amazingly, he ended up dead. You gave him this indictment, he took it to Joab and said, put him in the forefront of the battle so that he's sure to die. Is this the same David who numbered the people after you, God, told him not to? God, are we talking about the same David that you want me to live like? Now, it's amazing how those of us who have sinned always seem to want justice evenly distributed, you know, to those who do wrong. But when it comes to us and our sins, we kind of want God, you know, mercy and grace and all of that kind of stuff. You notice that Jeroboam didn't say, well, regardless, God, of our differing views on David, I did kind of set up those idols. I did invite the people to worship the golden calves. It's true, I wasn't faithful to you. I don't want to spend time worrying about David. You are the sovereign God. You're the judge. It's your job to deal with him. But as for you and me, God, I'm guilty. He didn't seem to think that way. But what Jeroboam is suggesting that here, let's not talk about me, God, let's talk about David. And I cannot believe that a holy God would describe David as one who kept his commands, followed you all with all of his heart, and did only what was right in your eyes. And brethren, truth be told, I felt the same way. I wondered. Now, I'm assuming that you all out there will agree with me that God is not challenged regarding his memory. I don't think that God has forgotten anything. God remembers all. You know, the Bible says that he not only knows the number of hairs on your head, mine is kind of thin. Mr. Washington has even less. You take a guy like Charlie here, wow, he got a bunch of hair. God not only knows the number of hairs on our head, but he recalibrates every time we get a haircut. That's just how awesome he is. This God is very conscious of what's going on. He is not one who forgets his covenant. He is faithful to what he says. He says that he will not lie. So then, what is this problem with David? The only conclusion that I can come up with is that when David prayed in Psalm 51, have mercy upon me, O God, according to your loving kindness, according to the multitude of your tender mercies, blot out my transgressions. Purge me with hyssop, and I will be whiter than snow. The only thing that I can conclude is that God did it. It's not that God forgot. God erased it. He blotted it out. It did not exist. It's gone, erased. Absent from God's memory bank. The Bible says he cast our sins into the depths of the sea. He remembers them no more. The Bible says he removes them as far as the east is from the west. And so God had no problem telling others, just like he told Jeroboam, David, who kept my commands and followed me with all his heart, doing only what was right in my eyes. Yes, David was a man after God's own heart. God sees David as saved, cleansed, and forgiven. And the same is true for us when we sincerely repent. But notice, that's not all that David said. In Psalms 51, verses 1 through 13, David said, "Then," everybody say, "Then." David says, "Then will I teach transgressors your way, and sinners shall be converted unto you." I'm sincere in this thing. If you forgive me for what I've done, I'm going to turn my life all the way around. And then I'm going to live my life in such a way that will bring honor and glory to you. Then I will bring others unto you. And you know, brethren, God answered that prayer. Isn't that amazing? God answered that prayer. Psalms 51, verses 1 through 13. Create in me a clean heart, O God. Restore unto me the joy of your salvation. Help my eyes to see what you want me to see and know where I'm going. And then I will teach others your way. What's your relationship with God? I have a song that I want to play for you. It's on YouTube. And it's a long song, so please be patient. It's called "Well Done." And it's a song by Ty Trivet. I didn't know who he was until just recently, but I heard the song while back, a couple years, maybe so ago. I think it's a very fitting song. So I'm going to ask Sush if he would get that particular song and play it for us on YouTube.
Thank you.
Practice. In Jesus' name, amen.
Amen.